Welcome. As some of you may have known, I am, or rather was, a member of the T4G blacklist. Never bragged about it, I also did not put it into my signature, so why am I telling you this now? I am telling you this to introduce you to the topic of this video. I will talk a lot about of stuff that I wanted to talk about a long time ago, but I never had the occasion because as long as you are in the blacklist, as a member, there's a principle of sharing no internal information. So, without further ado, let's get to it. It was back in December 2012 when I sent in my first submission to the blacklist. It was actually a submission with a video, but it seems I added a wrong link, so AJ contacted me to provide the correct link, and in the end it turned out that the submission did not proceed because the evidence was not accepted. It was a video of someone using the MiG-29 glitch to crash into a Black Hawk and survive without any scratch or barely any HP lost. But consequently, he asked me whether I want to join the T4G blacklist as a member. And I had doubts, because something else happened even earlier. It was during the time when the level cap was increased from 25 to 30. When I simply went onto a server to play as normal, and I see two attack helicopters not attacking each other, effectively calling a truce. And some of those that were involved with such a behavior were Nord and SureShot, and they were both members of the project, and I thought, yeah great, you have stats players in your project, because back then there was no definition, nothing. And it was the first time I actually saw something like this. But I immediately had the thought, this cannot be legal. And some time passed by, and I actually did not record it, because at that time I thought, there's absolutely nothing, no definition whatsoever, and there are no chances that this would ever become a bannable offense. So I did actually not record them. I mean, it would have been easy. I had preps right ready. And in hindsight, I have to say I regret this. But going on, I thought, yeah, why not at least give it a try and to see what other people think of it. I made a topic in the public official forum. The forum isn't always a place that you want to go to, because there's a lot of useless posts and topics going around. Sometimes I also spare myself a bit when I'm in the mood. But for this topic I put in some effort, and I basically took a Wikipedia statement about stats padding, a definition, and created an analogy to this behavior, this truthing. And it was in general very well perceived, and interestingly there were actually those helicruisers showing up, and they actually used quite aggressive and offensive arguments, so to speak, to denounce me. I mean, they could have simply ignored the topic, but it was at least that important that they felt the need to reply. So that was already a small win. It actually got so far that an EA representative had to step in and intervene, and actually settle the situation. And what's more, there was actually a forum moderator, and he said, this is a behavior that I actually would ban on a server I administrate, because the forum moderators manage the Q community team servers 1-4. So that was already quite nice to have as a result, and I thought, yeah, perhaps later on there will be an occasion to deal with this headache routing. But for the time being, I thought, yeah, simply give the blacklist a try and join and see how things work out. And so I accepted the invitation and became a part of the project and got familiar with the mechanisms and the voting procedure and everything else to, yeah, take part in the everyday voting. Initially, there were two topics in the public forum about the blacklist. They still exist, however, there's only the topic itself explaining what the T4G blacklist stands for, one in the German and one in the English forum, and they are closed with no replies. That was not always the case. A long time ago, those topics were open like most others and you could simply post in them. And as to the nature of the blacklist, there were lots of complaints about bans. And those topics actually had quite a nice entertainment value, so some days I simply scanned some of the replies for my own entertainment. And especially in the German one, one time there was a pretty big discussion because someone used a cheat on his server for 5 minutes and he was caught, I think by GGC. And there were a lot of complaints from him. And he even compared the blacklist to an institution of the Third Reich. That was pretty drastic, pretty dramatic. And the discussion went back and forth. And in the end, a moderator had to intervene. And in total, I think there were 27 pages deleted. Now, that was pretty funny. However, something else happened that was not funny at all. There was a person that was asking a question about his appeal. It was actually a pretty normal question. Not arrogant, not offensive, not aggressive, not anything like that. And even if it would have been any of those, that still does not give Nord the justification to do what he did. Because he went into that topic, the German topic, so that's why I guess it did not catch that much attention, and stated content of the appeal. And that was a breach of the rule to share no internal information. And it was quickly noted by other people and players posting on the topic, and they were also asking, yeah, how can you do something like that? What gives you the right to share this information, and there has to be some kind of punishment. And I thought to myself, I really want to intervene and actually add more oil to the fire. I really had the urge to do so. But I thought, I mean, I am perhaps just about a month in the project. I think I cannot really afford to do that. And I wanted to see how things like that get handled. And eventually, Rönel showed up, the creator of the T4G blacklist, and he said, basically, Nord already did so many good things, we are not going to remove him now. That was a pretty weak answer, and that showed me Rönel is not the leader type guy that can also make hard and critical decisions when it is needed. So eventually, both topics, the English and the German one, were completely, so to speak, cleaned, and then all posts were deleted, and the evidence was lost. Now, I still had this grudge against those helletrusers, but I knew I need evidence. And one of the things that actually motivated me to take part in such a submission was the fact that by now, Funky had established this official definition of what is dead spelling in the rental servers section. And what also pissed me off was that there was a screenshot of this little big cannon floating around in the German section, and he was basically, well, someone else was posting it, and yeah, it was basically bragging about a score that was not even earned by legit means. So that is where my motivation came from. And there was a first submission where he also took part himself, which was not even allowed. He simply did so at that point in time, it was still possible. And I also took part in the submission myself, and I tried to gather some things that would serve as evidence. And what I got in that screenshot that was posted in the forum, of course, he had a pretty high kill death ratio, even zero deaths, and of course, the score breached that you can see in game, that 16,000 something. But interestingly, the opposing not pilot, you cannot see him as pilot in this that screenshot, but the guy on the first place in the scoreboard of the other team also had the score breaching the numbers that you can see in game. And that other guy actually admitted to me that he heli cruised. I did not even do that intentionally, I just threw a little side remark at him and said, yeah, is heli cruising still fun? And unexpectedly, he actually admitted it. So I had the evidence for the opposing pilot. But the problem was, even though it was obvious as fuck, in theory, it still does not prove for 100% that they heli-truthed in that particular screenshot. So, the first submission went by. Now, one of the admins, Solman, said, yeah, I can't see anything that was would serve as evidence. And the other one, Captain Carrot, said simply heli-haw and voted disapprove. So that showed to me he did not even take a look at what I actually wrote. So it was pretty disappointing to me, but I thought I definitely need evidence. As long as I don't have anything that serves as clear evidence, I don't even need to try. But that occasion arised pretty soon, because after that submission, there was a bit of discussion in the Skype group, especially since he, as a matter of fact, voted in his own submission, which was not allowed. And AJ actually asked, what about heli-truthing? And I thought, why not emphasize on that? And I added, yeah, what about that? And then he replied, yeah, maybe not fair, but many did it. And when I saw that, I immediately took a screenshot and also a video, because that is a lesson that I have learned from Nord, Shoulder Shot and the heli cruising. When you see something that might become evidence at a later point, simply save it, store it, and when the time is right, bring it on. So, now I had what I needed, and I recreated the submission about him, and I made it quite long, and I also added all that other stuff, because what I thought is it not only needs to be proven, it also needs to be explained why heli-truthing is actually, or why it should be, a bannable offense, and why you actually cannot tolerate that. So I also used the other not 100% evidence, and I showed the submission to two fellow German speaking moderators, and I gave it to them and said, here, if you want, have a look at it, and if you feel like it, take part in the submission. And they actually did. Now, the intention of that was to actually validate the German-speaking part, because the opposing heli pilot that admitted his truthing, that had me in the German forum, so I wanted to validate that the translation that I provided is actually true. And I also wanted some intelligent replies, because sometimes there's a lot of stupidity in that project, a lot of stupid votes, and I thought would be nice to have some intelligent votes. So they actually decided to take part in the submission, and eventually the moderator votes passed by, and 4 voted for approve, equal ban, and there was 1 against the ban, and that one was Gaza. And his vote was, we don't ban for heli-truthing. Now the first thing was, that was not even discussed yet. And the second thing, he is in the same group, slash clan or clan, as Little Big Cannon. So, clan member protects clan member. And clan members voting on each other submissions is not allowed. So again, a breach of the protocol. So then the submission reached the admin level. The first vote came in, then the second, but after the second vote, the submission was still not decided. So, as a matter of drawing logic consequences, one admin voted voted yes, and the other one voted no. So, one yes vote and one no vote. I will actually explain the voting procedure later on. And then, Little Big Cannon actually made a topic in the internal forum, because I think by now he was a bit scared that he actually could be banned for real, and another discussion took place. And I also participated a bit myself. However, those heli-truthers were bringing up a lot of resistance, not even that good arguments, but when you are faced with such resistance, even though it's stupid, it sometimes can be hard to argue against all of that. But there was another admin that is really good at arguing and is also very endurable, so he helped a lot with that. And yeah, he actually went so far that he completely stomped on their arguments. And in the end, he also decided to take part in that submission, and he brought the second yes vote. So the result of the submission was actually a ban for stat spelling. Yeah, and for great justice. Now that took an aggravating amount of time, but at least in the end it happened. So, with that being covered, on to the next point. After that submission, things got a bit quiet again. People going back to normal to their submissions and doing votes. But that one day, I found that Nogress mod, simply in a casual topic in the forum, official public forum, there was a talk about modifications, and I saw that command and I thought, yeah, why not use it to piss some people off and potentially cause some drama. Nah, just kidding, that was not the real reason I was using the mod. I simply used it because I never liked grass in the first place, and I thought, yeah, there's no grass on low anyway, so it should not be much of a problem. That's what I thought, but in the end it turned out differently. Way differently. So there was this guy, HPV6, -6 to be technically correct, and he did not like that at all, and he even tried to gather support internally against me to actually ban me or exclude me from the project or whatever, and actually treat Nogress as a bannable offense. Now, it did not really work out well for him to gather internal support, so what he did eventually was to step into the public, go to the public forum, and make a topic, post one of my videos in it, and basically ask whether this is allowed. So basically, open disagreement. And yeah, there was a lot of discussion in the topic. It also contained staff of the T4G blacklist arguing against each other, or mainly against this HPV6 guy. And it actually was a total public relationship disaster. Now, eventually, an easy representative showed up and he said, I will get a reply from the upper hand, from the company itself. Yeah. And a bit later he returned with that also clarifying reply that basically is just a reference to the end user access and license agreement. So basically, all kind of modifications outside of the game client constitute a violation of the EU ALA, or whatever it is called. So, of course, that was very unsatisfying, and something needed to be done, and this file modding policy was established. But initially, it does not have the current form. That means those mods, especially those visible mods, were not differentiated like today. You see that one list of mods that are allowed, for example, Nogress mod, and you see some mods that are not allowed to be used, like No Trees, and Ultimate View, and so on and so forth. Originally, there was just a sentence at the end of the policy that said, for that cases with those mods, it will be decided on a case-to-case scenario how to handle this. And that of course was a pretty paradox sentence, because how would it work out? Like, for that particular submission you won't ban that mod, and for the other one you will do. And for that HPV6 guy, it was not enough. So Svorek actually created a submission against me. HPV6 decided to take part as a moderator, so he voted yes. All other votes were no, by the way. And when the submission reached the admin level, the policy was corrected, or rather adjusted, and now it has a form that you can see today. And interestingly, Perforator actually went into the submission and added that into additional evidence. There's basically a field inside of submissions where you can post additional stuff, and he posted a link to that policy. So before any admin votes came in, the link was already there. And what happened? Nord actually decided to vote against the policy and simply vote for ban, even cheating ban. And he brought up some pretty retarded argumentation, if you can even call it that. And he on purpose decided to vote against the policy. Now luckily, the other two admins voted confirmed to the policy, and in the end, ban took not place. And consequently, there was a bit of forum beef, because I was pretty pissed about Nord simply voting against the policy and doing what he just sees fit. And of course, Gaza was the first one to defend him, saying something like, no, he didn't mean it that way, and you can't blame him, and blah 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 blah. And Nord was pretty much pissed himself, because this new policy was established, and he even made a video to show how the Nogress mod actually should be bannable, And he was, because he was so pissed, he even made a call about his removal and said, do you want not to be moved? And surprisingly, that poll even got split results. That means 10 votes were to voted to keep him, and 9 votes actually voted for his removal. And I actually brought forward this earlier behavior of him, of sharing internal information, and I said, yeah, you should have been gone long from the project, because you have shared internal information. And there was no reply to that one, because there were no arguments. And to close down this discussion about this no-grass mod. Now, of course there was this rather confusing statement, but think about it logically. When you apply common sense, now, there was this guy posting this video, and there's an EA representative, and he shows it to his upper hand, to his boss. And if that would be a modification that would be treated as cheating, wouldn't it make sense to actually ban me? But no, that did not happen. Of course, they can still do if they want to, for this reason or no reason at all, due to the terms of service. But I don't really think that will happen. Of course, I can't be sure, but that's just my opinion, and of course I have no insight on what's going on inside of Easy, but if I would have to guess, I think they don't see this as a cheat-like modification. Now, before I address the next point, I will introduce you to the communicational and power structure of the T4G blacklist. Now, there is the internal forum, which is supposed to be used for serious discussions and discussions not to be lost, and then there are several Skype groups. First of all, there's a group for moderators. I mean, I know that one because I was part of it. Then there's a group of admins. Sometimes I talk with admins about different stuff, and sometimes they refer to the admin Skype group of and saying, yeah, this time nothing happened, and the other time there was a lot of discussion about blah blah blah. So yeah, admin group definitely also exists, and somewhere there also must be the group for the lead team. And then there's also T4G spam. I mean, it's not really called T4G spam, however, it's called T4G general, and that is where also a lot of off-topic stuff goes in. And when you're not online for some days, it can also simply happen that there are about 1,000 new messages. So what the Skype group is basically good for if you want to have a quick reply or a quick discussion. And now to the power structure. There are, first of all, moderators. Initially, those had no powers at all, no decisive power. That means, no matter what admins, what moderators voted, the submission would always reach the admin level. After some time, there was a new mechanism introduced, so when all 5 moderators, originally even 6, was reduced to 5 at some point to reduce the workload. So when 5 nodes vote no, the submission is denied before it reaches admin level. So after such a long time, at least a bit of power for the moderators. And when a submission reaches the admin level, the decision is 2 out of 3. So when 2 admins vote yes for a submission, the result is a ban. When they vote no, there will be no ban, and the same thing for appeals. 2 yes votes for lift appeal, appeal is lifted, and the same thing vice versa. And besides that, there are members that have additional powers. Most notably, the lead team, which for example can invalidate submissions, or invalidated by part, so the admins would have to vote again, and they can also appoint new members and remove members from the project. And this lead team was established because over time Werner began to act more and more passive, and he shared some of his powers with others, so they would take care of the project. And I think that was a pretty big mistake, because when power is not controlled, there's much room for abuse. I will refer to that actually later on. So, as you can see, quite obviously, there's a quite big democratic deficit. And that's what I'm going to show you right now. A good amount of time ago, my clan had a clan war against this fools group as part of this Bundeswehr League. And Little Bill Cannon actually took part in that match, and I could not understand why or how he would be able to be part, because the league servers had the cheating, stat padding and glitching list, so he should have been kicked by the stat padding list. However, he was moved to a new list, the so-called strict terms of service enforcement list. And, well, why did this happen? Well, it happened because Gaza wanted to have his member participate in that clan war. And if you think about it, well, it's a new list that almost no one uses, so it's basically as good as an unban. In my opinion, a pretty obvious abuse of power. But when I brought this issue up later on, I got nothing but negativity and disapproval. So, because eventually the lead team decided to bring in some democracy, I was like, wow, they really risk that? And how grateful of them. So, they said, yeah, we made this discussion about the no-grass mod and also moving the elite housing to this new list, and now, we are going to have some democracy. So there was this poll made about elite housing going back to stat spelling list, and that is where I posted the content of that match and where they bought in their member by moving Little Bill Cannon to that list. And that's where Captain Carrot said, oh my god, Delta Force, you're causing again nothing but clan drama, just shut the hell up. And he was blind to the obvious flaw of Gaza abusing his personal power for his personal gain. But eventually, the poll finished, the majority voted for moving Truthing back to stat spelling, and in the end, all was good. But of course, it was not really necessary to have that ban being moved in the first place. And I actually intended to do a video about how to use the no-grass mod for quite a long time, because I thought, I'm using it now, and of course you can gain the knowledge yourself by visiting certain sites that offer that knowledge, but might be a nice move to just make a short, concrete video about it. And first I asked Solman, and he basically replied, nah, it's going to cause a lot of drama again, and those fools guys will be pissed, yada yada yada. And I thought, sorry that I asked. And so that was the first try. And another time, I decided to ask AJ, and he also said, no, still not a good idea. And he especially mentioned that people could make a poll about this, and basically turn this all around and make it a bannable offense. And I thought, why not actually make a poll about it, because even though I actually liked the decision of the lead team to add the Nogress mod on the list of mods that are allowed to use. If you apply critical thinking to it, it was just one of those decisions that they made by themselves, so there was actually no democracy. So I thought, yeah, actually making a poll is quite a good idea. But before that, I wanted to have Nord and SureShot removed, because they were all part of this vendetta plan by HPV6, because when we had this discussion, I actually asked him, because there were also some other guys saying, yeah, I'm using this mod, this Nogress mod. So I asked him, so here, there are also some others saying that they use this mod, shouldn't you be equally mad at them? And he literally said, I don't care about them, I care about you. So, from that point on, it was clear it was just a mean for vendetta, and he actually did not care about the Nogress mod as something as a banner of offense. It was simply a mean for him to get his revenge for Little Big Cannon, I guess, because they at that point in time were in the same group slash clan. And of course, Nord and SureShot would support that vendetta. So I wanted them to be removed. Also simply because they are stat spellers, and stat spellers don't belong in this project. So I talked a bit with the lead team about how they are no good addition to the project, especially since they were inactive for quite a long time by now. Not sure if that was the reason they got removed, but perhaps it helped a bit. So yeah, with them being out of the way, I actually brought up that poll by myself, because there were still some people posting about this mod and actually asking whether it should be added to the mods that get banned for cheating, like No Trees and Ultimate View. And I was quite a bit pissed about that, because I thought by now all this Nogress stuff is finally been dealt with, but it seems not, and so I made this poll, and I also used quite some direct words. So here's a poll, and go ahead and vote with whatever you want to vote, but take into account I'm using this mod, and if you want to have me added on the cheating list, yeah, go ahead and do so, but no more of this half-assed and half-bullshit crap. So the poll took place, and in the end, 6 votes to add this to the list of bannable mods, and 7 votes to keep the status quo. So in the end, it did not happen. And surprisingly, even Gaza said that he would actually give a free pass to everyone that used it before, but even then that looked pretty paradox. If I had a mod used on my videos, that now would be seen as illegal. But that did not happen, so it's not really worth to talk about that. And I don't really know whether this video of Nord happened before or after his removal. I think shortly after. But that video actually showed a bit of macros, how macros work, and why one of those cases was actually banned for macro. And I had just gotten into that macro stuff myself, and I approached it from a theoretical point of view, like taking into account stats and seeing how stocks affect the recoil and how what patterns you would expect, and how it would change and how what you can expect of a human. But in the end, it's not easy for me to admit that, but it was actually quite helpful to see how a recoil macro works for real. By now that video no longer exists, or it was made unlisted, but at that point in time it was pretty helpful, even though it was quite a bit paradox again, because it was basically someone using, I guess, what can be seen as cheat, for his research. And players are not the ones that are tasked with using and testing cheats, or So. And it was actually known that Nord was using those macros for testing. I even mute myself at some point. Yeah, and I said, well, if he only uses them on unranked servers, well, okay. Because actually, that's something that deserves a critical point of view, but I thought, I'm already addressing so many stuff and pissing so many people off. Yeah, why not just go let the lead team deal with this and have them do something for a change of pace and demonstrate some of their professionalism. So yeah, the problem was after Nord's removal, pretty soon there was a lot of resistance for this no recoil macro cases by AJ and also Solman. And especially Solman's arguments were quite retarded in my opinion, because he said you can't know the skill, their connection and a lot of other things like lag. Well, if a video has lags or it is sped up or slowed down, you cannot use it for evidence. But if a video is normal, like it is fluent and there's no slowdown or anything like that, you can actually use it for evidence. Because in the end, controlling recoil is not something that is super individual for each player, except some do it faster and some slower, but in the end it's always the same movement. Like when you have an AAK, you will always have to move your mouse down to compensate for the vertical recoil. And there's simply a limit as to what a human is able to do. But for him, this whole macro stuff was subjective. And that once more revealed the conflict between the member tiers. So when an admin takes a different road than moderator, it is no problem as long as the moderator does not care about that opinion of his. Or he simply thinks, yeah, let the admin handle it. But if a moderator disagrees with the opinion of an admin and is still convinced that his opinion is the correct one, that is where problems start to occur. And there have been several instances where admins overruled moderator votes. Sometimes, submissions where there were 5 conform moderator votes, so all of them voting for approve, equal ban. And there were even votes where there was already someone banned for a macro, so five or four moderator votes, and definitely 2 admin votes that voted yes. And then, of course, the appeal with, again, moderator votes for the appeal and admin votes. And there was especially a case where, in total, when you count together the votes for submission and appeal, 11 votes voted for no recoil macro, and in the end, 3 votes, 1 moderator and 2 admins, the admins that participated in the appeal, voted, lift ban because I'm not convinced. Well, of course you can have your own opinion, that's perfectly fine, even if it is a retarded opinion, you still have the right to have it. But the conflict and the problem here is the lack of democracy, and, well, if the moderators play no role in those submissions, why not simply have only the admins decide about them in the first place? And because I thought my opinion and also the opinion of others should be valued, I actually also decided to resubmit some cases where I did not agree with the result, because the Solman was arguing, sometimes there are decisions that are not made by the majority, and you cannot force me to not vote in them or have an opinion that I do not present. And I thought, okay, you are free to have your opinion, and I am free to resubmit those cases, and perhaps get some admins to vote that have a different opinion. And that faced, and then I was faced with a lot of criticism, and someone basically said something like, resubmitting cases is not going to happen. I was like, sure, that is really a good idea. What if I just find someone else to actually submit the cases for me, and then I actually take part in the voting process instead of submitting them myself. So yeah, that was just for. He did that because, of course, for him, he did not want those cases to be proceeded and to be banned because, in our opinion, macros cannot be proven from video evidence. Well, there was one submission, yes, one where he actually voted yes in one of those macro cases, but the interesting thing is the guy that was banned appealed, and in the appeal he had a complete 180 degree turnover, so that means he completely changed his opinion. And there was also another admin voting no, and he, well, Solomon, as a result of mistake of clicking the wrong button, actually voted yes. So the the appeal was denied because he took the wrong button, so to speak. And I was pretty pissed about that because it was, once again, yeah, a submission where someone was already banned and so many opinions were stepped over. So I actually literally went into the forum and said, are you out of your mind? And that statement had two different messages. The messages for, message for Solomon was to, yeah, respect the majority, and the message for the other and was, please just reconsider this case and take a second look. And in the end, the ban was upheld for the time being at least. But of course, Solomon could not afford to have those players banned, and eventually those macro cases were all cancelled. Jenny was posting a topic about how those macro cases were so unfair and how you can approve it, yada yada yada. And of course Solomon liked that because that was exactly his thoughts, his mind, and he said, yeah, I think we should all cancel these cases. And eventually it happened, and it just happened. That means again the lead team decided to do so. There was no democracy, no poll, no nothing. And I thought, yeah, okay, when you act retarded and again execute your fake authority, at least be completely retarded and unban all macro cases. But there was still one, at least one that I checked, Fat Gazelle or whatever he was called, and that one was actually not unbanned. Why? I don't know, but his lead admin friend, Captain Carrot, actually voted in that case, so maybe that was the reason. I don't know. And yeah, there was also a poll about macro list, like creating a separate list for macros. And yeah, pretty retarded because macros are cheating. Like an aimbot or a wall hack, simply it's cheating. And yeah. Why was this idea brought up? Yeah, of course, because Solomon wanted to have something to put those subjective cases on, even though he already basically unbanned all of them. And yeah, that was the poll, and after some time I even changed my vote from no to yes, but this was more a sign of resigning. Like, I mean, if they really want to, they can decide it anyway, so what does it even matter? And yeah, just let them have their macro list and be happy, even though it's against my personal conviction. And next up, I will actually give you a demonstration of Solomon's voting behavior, because except for that one submission, he always voted no. Not conclusive, not subjective, but it's I have to structure my thoughts. It is subjective, and that is why we cannot ban those cases. So this case was, so to speak, cooperation between TUF and Bundeswehr Clown. And what happened here was, there was one guy on Sharky Rush having some teammates, medics especially to revive him and also a recon with a motion sensor. But he also had a server admin with him that actually would, so to speak, tactically remove certain players. So I guess to create a bash-friendly environment. But that was not everything. And that is actually already quite retarded, because you want to earn respect by manipulating the server. But no, beyond that point, there were actually players on the opposing team that were communicating with the attacking team, some of them. So it was actually a truce. Now the thing was, the video had no sound. They disabled the sound, I guess, because they thought they are smart, so no one will catch the truthing. But it was really obvious to see, especially I think during the first 10 minutes, there was, yeah, this medic at the Bravo MCOM of the first stage, and there's this one person that he keeps reviving over and over, and the person on the roof is killing that person over and over. So even though there was no evidence as of now, or at least it seemed to be no evidence there, it was pretty obvious that truthing happened. So the first submission goes through, and there are actually, I guess I'm using actually way too much, there are two admins voting yes, and you cannot really blame them for doing so, because the score was over 50,000, and those scores don't happen under normal circumstances on Sharky Rush. So it should have been a ban, because as you remember, two admin votes that vote yes equals a ban. And Soulman also voted, and he voted no, and he even worded his message as if there was no truthing for him. Like, for him it was not about finding the evidence, for him it was simply no truthing happened. And I found that pretty retarded, once again. And the crucial thing is, that is one of those cases where someone used his higher power to actually, yeah, make the submission invalid. Maybe it was even Solomon himself, I don't know. So why am I telling you this particular case? Well, first of all, to demonstrate his voting behavior, but also to show something else, because one of those things Solomon stated for those macro cases were, yeah, the admins are going to deal with it and decide how they are handled, suggesting that there would be a union among the admins. And no, there is no V, not among the moderators, not among the admins, and you would expect, well, at least there got to be a union among the lead team, but apparently not even that is always the case. There was a second submission with this person, and it was actually submitted by someone else that we banned for choosing in a similar fashion, and that person added a small scene, and in that scene you can see that the attacking person in the attacking team aims at one of the medics, and he has a free field of view. There's no other enemy that actually would force him to take cover, or that would draw his attention away. No. Free field of sight. And he aims at the enemy for several seconds, and then he unaims. So he intentionally ignores an 100% easy to take kill. And that was the evidence that was needed. And AJ took part in that second submission and voted yes. So, and in combination with another yes vote, it actually led to a ban. He normally does not take part in the voting procedure. He mainly takes care of all the technical stuff. But for this submission he did so. I don't know why, but I'm very thankful that he did so. And yeah, just as a demonstration, not even among the lead team, there's always an agreement. And it shows you once again that Solomon perhaps is not the most competent and clever person in the world. So, next up, we have a row of failures. Yeah. And the first one is the story with the flipped helicopter. Perhaps it sounds complicated, but very easy. First of all, there was someone with a score of 59,000, almost 60k, so a pretty obvious standard stat-splitting score. And he got bad. And he sends in an appeal, and what he says is, like, he shot a helicopter on the helipad, and that basically gained him such a high score. Now, in theory, it's possible, but it's so unlikely it can actually exclude it with a probability of almost 100%. So, what is required? Well, first of all, there needs to be a pilot that takes off with the helicopter, flips it around, and lands the helicopter on the helipad. In that flipped or downturned, whatever you want to call it, state. And then there needs to be this jet pilot that shoots the helicopter. And when a helicopter is upside down on a helipad, well, it of course takes damage, but it is also repaired at the same time. Now, back in that time, it could also be that the helicopter still repaired automatically when you did not need ground crew supply for that. But even if that requirement is actually met, it's still kind of ridiculous because it requires a jet pilot to shoot the helicopter and then constantly, of course, gain score by shooting the helicopter once and gaining the experience of being damaged and healed all the time. And for such a long time that you would end up with a score of almost 60,000. Well, as for a comparison, even extremely talented pilots on Dragon Valley, when the match is pretty much one-sided, reach scores about 45,000 at maximum. And that was way higher. So, the bottom line is, it probably did not happen like that in the first place, so simply a good story. And if you start to believe stories like that, what does it lead to? Because just become a bit creative. Now everyone that has a similar score can simply send in an appeal and state, I shot a flipped helicopter and that gave me such a high score. Unban, please. The only thing that you would need is some jet score. So I guess 100,000 damage dealt for jet would be a pretty convincing score. And then you have to unban people that are, or basically you don't know if you are unbanning people that are actually guilty. So that was the first in a row of failures. On to the next one. Now, there has been a video of Rönel where he uses no tree and ultimate view mod. So no trees and I think almost no fog. And there was also a discussion in Skype chat, and that was I think when I saw that video actually for the first time. And I asked why would you do that? Why should there be this video of using those mods that are clearly cheating and that we also have in the list of mods that are not allowed to be used? And the reply that I got from Carrot was, he did not expect his friends to spread this video and use it against him. Now, the thing was, originally those Fool's guys were all, I guess, kind of big family, but after those Hated Truth bans and the removal of Norton Sure Shot, it was no longer peace and harmony, and Svorek actually decided, yeah, to submit Rune with this video. Sounds perhaps a bit backstabbing, but I mean, why would you upload a video of yourself using such mods, especially when you are the creator of the blacklist and in such a responsible position? Why would you even record? And to ask the most daring question, why would you even use those mods? There's absolutely no reason. So, proceeding with the list of failures, Pellets actually decided to post a comment under that video, and what he says is, if I remember correctly, well then, interesting, looks nice enough, and why would you post that? That basically suggests that you don't disapprove of this mod, yeah, that you actually don't care about this mod being used. So at a maximum, it's a statement that you should not give out. At a minimum, it's misleading and confusing. In my opinion, unnecessary and pretty retarded. And it does not stop. No. There were two submissions. The first one was for cheating, and the second one was for strict terms of service enforcement. I think there was some kind of pressure on the admins actually to not ban him, because I mean, after all, it's the creator of the blacklist. And that pressure came true also in the second submission, at least I think that is the motivation that one of the admins had. So Perforator voted, what did he vote? I don't believe Runner to use cheats, and otherwise his whole project would have no sense. And he also said, yeah, it would look bad if we had the creator of the blacklist on, yeah, the cheating list. So I guess there's still that kind of pressure. And the other admin vote was even worse, because yeah, it was simply dumb. It was made up of nothing but stupidity. So there's this Jenny, and she simply votes, we don't ban for no grass mod. Well, okay, yeah, the no grass mod was also used in this video, but that was not the mod in question. The mod in questions were the no tree mod and the mod for ultimate view / no fog, and how this should be handled and whether it should be banned. But no. Yeah. She voted like that, and of course no one actually said something about that. And I did not too, because yeah, there was already so much stuff going wrong. And I was already basically questioning so much stuff. Yeah, I thought I'm going to let this slide for now. And she also had a pretty nice argumentation fail in those macro discussions. She literally said, yeah, macros are used in so many shooters, so why should we even ban for them? So she actually said, yeah, macros are okay to be used. So once again, vitality, yeah, stupidity strikes. And yeah, we are not finished yet. No. Oh no. There has also been road choosing. That means there was this Kistoff guy, that CS Pro, that has this 53% headshot ratio on his A85A2 and is apparently legit. And yeah, this case actually had quite a funny procedure. Like, there have been several submissions, and sometimes he got banned, and another time he got unbanned. And in one of those unbanned banned stories and submissions, all of those Bundeswehr guys show up, and yeah, 5 Bundeswehr votes for the Moderators Votes and also to Admin Votes. Also from the Bundeswehr Clan. So, trying to protect their clan member and protectionism at its best. And when they were asked why they did this, yeah, they said, yeah, at this time, Christoph was not part of our clan yet. So, pretty big excuses. Soon after, all of them were gone. And he used a video to get himself unbanned or to demonstrate his playstyle. Well, there's a big danger with those videos when you accept them as material for an appeal, because a video is something that you decide. You decide what you want to do in the video, yeah, what goes in the video, and what you don't include in the video. And if a video does not turn out the way you want it to be, simply go ahead and do a second try. And yeah, again, some creative thinking. Now, let's say someone wants to use a cheating program, but not one of those regular aimbots that are, first of all, very easy to spot in-game. You just need a couple of recordings showing the snapping, and most of the times they also get caught pretty fast by Punkbuster. So let's assume one of those advanced cheats, and let's assume, repeating words like a pro, this cheating tool would have two traits. First of all, aim assist, that means the cursor would not jump straight onto the target to look less suspicious, so with a set movement speed that would fit a normal player or perhaps a bit above the average. And automatic gravitation correction, so that means this cheating tool would calculate the distance between you and your target, and the cheating tool would make your weapon aim above your opponent accordingly, so you would basically almost land headshots. And now let's assume that person, yeah, of course, will eventually get those high headshot ratios, but to preserve himself, he records videos in advance. So that means, for example, you can reach those headshot ratios by going into spawns, yeah, and aiming for the head and getting a lot of those headshot lethal kills that you don't receive with regular gameplay. Also, just exclusively aiming for the head and even, yeah, taking deaths if you can't get a headshot. And then you record enough videos to look representative of this behavior and say, here, that's how I play, that's how I get my headshot ratios. Yeah, and then you will be unbanned because, yeah, oh yeah, he approved his playstyle and now we have to unban him. And yeah, once you've passed that point, no one will again ask any more questions. And then you could even use a cheating tool and no one would notice until it's too obvious, like in the example stated before. So that is a pretty major drawback with all this video unbanning nonsense for appeals. And the best one to demonstrate that is that S4X guy with those 80% headshot ratios on various weapons. And he did that now so often with those videos, yeah, no one questions him anymore, and now he could have any headshot ratio on any weapon, and it would not even matter if it would be by an aimbot, because no one asked any more questions. So, that's the drawback. Okay, going on. Whitelist. That's a pretty big one. Now, first of all, the term whitelist is pretty paradox by itself. Because, well, now there's this blacklist and it provides this list that you can use on your server for cheating, set splitting and so on, and the basic idea behind this list is we add everyone to those lists that fits our criteria for cheating, set splitting, etc. Now, what does this whitelist do? Well, it gives server admins the options to make exceptions. And yeah, of course you can go that sort of moralic way of thinking and saying, yeah, we don't make that exception, that inequality ourselves, we simply go and give the server admins the tools to do so, but that is pretty whack and weak, in my opinion. The blacklist should provide this list as an option and say, here is a list, and your option is either you accept it as a whole or you deny it as a whole. And none of this in-between nonsense. And of course, there's also a pretty big potential for abuse. Yeah, someone can simply use a whitelist to cheat. So that means he can add himself to the list and cheat all day long. And how are you going to prove that? Because the person is already banned for cheating, glitching or whatever. So the evidence for this illegal behavior is already given. And now, to prove the abuse, you would have to show that this person still uses cheats. And even if you take a video, how does the video prove when the cheating actually happened? Because you can record a video and upload it now or later. So that's actually no proof. Now the only exception that you perhaps can find is like when a new item enters the game. Like let's say the person has cheated before the A91 was released and now the video is recorded after the weapon is released and you can actually see the weapon also used in the kill feed. Yeah, I guess that perhaps would work as evidence for cheating still after the whitelist is used. But that would actually take a lot of effort, so, and the players really should not be forced to put in so much effort to prove someone that he's abusing the whitelist. So, as I said, pretty big room for potential of abuse. And the most striking aspect was the idea of the whitelist was decided against the majority. It was no democratic decision. I still remember it like it was yesterday. 69% of the votes that participated in the whitelist poll were against the introduction of the whitelist. And it still got through, because the lead team, or I think especially Rönne in this case, wanted it, so it was also pretty awkward. Like, the poll is finished, and then Rönne steps in and says, board gonna work on it, and I think, hello, the majority was against it, not for it. No means no, and not yes, and well, but at that point in time, I actually did not address it, because when you are faced with nothing but disapproval, and what is the other word I'm looking for? Aversion. At some point, it can happen that you lose the motivation to make noise and speak up against all this bullshit that is happening. So, at that point in time I said, yeah, okay, just do whatever you want. And who's actually the one that profits from the whitelist? Well, it's a pretty folk. And what do I mean by that? Well, those that can afford to rent servers, server admins, and of course I can also put everyone on the whitelist they know. And the other one would be those that have a certain status. Like extremely popular YouTubers, or someone is known in the forum perhaps. So even if you don't know a server admin, some of you may simply add you to the whitelist simply because of your status. So that's that are the ones that profit from the whitelist. And of course Pellets was very fond of this idea, because I mean it was his friend, and he wanted to him to be added to the whitelist and to actually allow him to play on the servers, so So much for that. Now, before I go on, just some other aspects I would like to mention that I forgot to mention earlier. The admin that took part in the Little Big Cannon submission that voted no was sure shot. So that was yet another example of clan member protecting clan member. And the same reasoning as Gaza, we don't ban for elite losing. And the other thing, ah yeah, there's this Linux guy, and he's really fond of this principle, chain of command, and he actually accused me of sentencing people to death, simply because I voiced my opinion and because I was convinced those macro cases were indeed cheating. Even though I actually had no power by myself. Yeah, in the end it were the admins that took the decision. I don't blame the admins, and if I would have been admin, I actually would have voted the same way, but so much for that. Okay, there was also some other discussion concerning this Synastix case. There was even a poll asking about whether he should be unbanned, despite him having a GGC ban. So it was technically proven that there has cheating happened on his account. And that is what the T4G Blacklist bans for. It bans accounts, not the players. Every player is free to make a new account if he has a ban. So there were people willing to give him a special treatment. Luckily that opinion was not the majority, but just for reference, there were some of them wanted to give him special treatment and yeah, introduce inequality. Also worth to mention, there's this whole story of his account being hacked, account data taken against his will. However, in one of his videos he actually says that he had other persons use his account and level it up and do whatever, I don't know. And we had an EA representative inside of the project, and he actually told us that there has been no security leak at EA whatsoever. So, in consequence, that means whatever happened there, it was not the fault of EA, it was simply someone sharing his account data with people that in the end seemingly were not trustable. That's everything to it. And going on, there was a German YouTuber that asked me and another moderator whether we actually would be willing to do a video about the blacklist. Yeah. Just some general video with a bit of information how T4G blacklist works. Just the general information that you basically already can find on the forum threads. Because blacklist is actually quite popular and known in the English speaking community, and I thought, it cannot hurt to actually give it a slight boost for the German speaking community and actually offer a different source of information. So, me and the other moderator went ahead and started recording and how we would set this up, how to manage the questions. And we actually did two versions. In the first version, I actually had a bit of flaming, where I flamed about this S4 guy basically being unbanned because he provided that video, those videos. And I thought, that's not really something that cannot be used in a video, because in the public, T4G Blacklist needs to present this idea of being a union and where everything is peaceful and harmony. And so we did the second version. And I thought, this one is really better, and I'm really proud of that myself, and I'm convinced that it is good. And Now, we basically just need to wait until the other members notice it and congratulate us for doing such a good job. I mean, I was not really out for the fame and for the glory, so to speak, but I was actually interested how people would react inside of the blacklist, because I mean, it could have went like no one would notice it at all, because for some reason the stuff that happens in the German section gains no attention for most of the time, like what I told you earlier, not mentioning content of an appeal. But it was noticed this time, so the video was noticed, and well, a few days later, Soman contacts me privately, and what he basically says is, there has been a video of similar fashion before by someone else, and on behalf of the lead and admin team or group, I ask you to remove this video. Yeah. And that instantly basically set me into rage mood for several reasons. One of them was when the discussion happened in the T4G general group, Skype group, there was actually an admin that took a look at the video and he said, yeah, I scanned the video and there is no harmful content. So there was already someone validating the content of the video, but that was not enough for Soulman. He needed someone that translated the whole video. I don't know who that did, but someone did it. And the second thing that pissed me off was this formulation, how he worded that. Like, the whole admin team wants the removal of the video. And I said, no, not going to happen. I also asked why, and the reply did not turn up initially, because I guess there was a bit of Skype lag. But what he said was, yeah, we'd want to avoid staff members saying negative things about the project. Yeah, stuff of that nature. Yeah, but I still did not agree with that, and sometime later, he actually comes up with another message and says, yeah, there's a management structure, and basically now it's either you remove the video, or we remove you too. Now, that did not make anything better. And how can you be so narrow-minded and stupid? Because now we made this video, and yeah, and it's on Mino's channel. And well, what are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to go to him and ask, yeah, Mino, remember that video that we did a short time ago? Can you please just set it to unlisted, or while you at it, just delete it completely? And then of course Mino would ask why, and then what would be our reply, like, yeah, we can't give you any reasons, please just do so. Do you think that would have worked out? I'm not sure. But, well, since we were in this together, and by this I mean me and the other moderator, I actually asked him, yeah, how should we handle this? Now, should we really try to remove the video? Or should we try to perhaps put up some, so to speak, resistance and yeah, go for an argument? Well, if he said, I don't want to risk that, and let's try to remove the video, I would have respected that. Because, yeah, gotta have to pay respect to your fellow people. But he said, yeah, I'm fine with trying go for a discussion, and said, okay, nice. And so he went for a more private approach. And after I came back, I actually took some time off to get my head together and to cool down a bit. I actually took the discussion into the internal forum. Well, and of course it was immediately seen as yet another drama caused by Delta Force. And as I do normally, I voice my opinion very directly and I don't put any flowers into my posts. So of course, sometimes people can also be offended. But it was actually quite helpful because it concealed the true intention. Because I thought, well, now there's a Solomon guy and he already has that superior position, and if I just try to solve this privately, he can just basically ignore any kind of argumentation, let it fall under the table, and yeah, remove us without any reason and without having to justify it. So I brought the discussion into the public forum to actually discharge the tensions, and I also wanted to see who are those admins that actually decided that this video should be removed. And there are some admins that I talk to from time to time about certain stuff, and this was one of the cases where I asked one of those admins and I requested him, can you please give me a statement about how this was handled in admin chat? And he replied to me. There was no agreement or anything like that. It was simply someone posting the video and asking whether it should be unlisted / removed. Yeah. And that's exactly what I expected, because in this project there are quite a lot of people that either don't care about voicing their opinion because they don't want to cause drama and put up a fight with, I guess, a superior tier, or because they simply don't mind being controlled by others, so essentially being mindless sheep. So there was actually no agreement among the admins. And following the discussion in the forum, there was also a discussion in the Skype group. And the crucial thing here was, now the main reason for removal was, or why it should be removed, because I did not ask the lead team. Now, I did not tell that to them, but, well, I'm not really the type of person that asks other persons what I should do. I mean, I already asked that question for that Nogress video, but I thought for this one, but of course I can ask others for their opinion and delete him, but in the end it will again be nothing, just like we need to discuss it, blah 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 blah, and I'm not someone that discusses things, or at least I don't prefer to just have a lengthy discussion about things and asking others. So I said, yeah, I will simply go ahead and do it because I'm a decision maker. I do things. And, well, it was actually pretty hard to find any valid counter arguments why the video should be removed. Basically, the only thing that had was that I did not ask the superior tier with the fake authority. And after that, was stale and no longer attractive. They were actually mentioning that I, this particular sentence, where I said that I'm not a fan of the whitelist in that video, and that sentence was blown out of proportions, like saying, yeah, one sentence can destroy everything and people can read things into it and yada yada yada. And of course the translator happily forgot to mention that later on in the video I said the T4G Blacklist is a project for players by players. At least that is what I believe myself at that point in time. I actually wanted to believe it for quite a long time. So, and yeah, the argument was that I should remove the video, or I should ask Minu to remove the video so it could be discussed what should be happening. And I said, well, assuming there is already a damage done, it really makes no sense to unlist or remove the video now, then have your discussion and then decide, oh yeah, video is okay. Then it's better to actually have your discussion first and then take actions if they are still necessary. And that secretly also had the intention of them discussing it first and not taking 7 days or whatever, or even longer time. And the argument was finished when I brought up the comparison to this previous no-grass discussion. And I said, well, if this problem, or if this case is already so drastic, so immense, what about those that previous case? That was open disagreement as its best. And after that, everyone was quiet. And about that previous video that I mentioned, which also included another T4G Blacklist moderator, that was quite a failure because the person that actually hosted that video was on the T4G Blacklist for some time for glitching. Thing is, it never was a valid ban. So here we have Baswa, and we have the central area where those trees are enclosed by those rectangular formations of walls, and close to one of those walls are some boxes, and you can jump onto them and actually get inside of those walls where those trees are. And that is what he managed to do, and this video was actually submitted, and yeah, all the moderators and admins that saw the submission, yeah, simply went by and just voted how they see it fit. And there was actually no discussion about how to handle this new behavior, because it never occurred before. And yeah, moderators voted, admins voted, and two admins voted yes, so yeah, this case was bad. And he sent in an appeal, a quite long appeal, in dual language, which means English and German. Yeah. And the appeal had actually a quite similar appearance. I mean, the appeal votes to the submission votes, because it was basically the same. Everyone just went ahead and had his opinion, and there was actually no agreement now whether is this just glitching or whether it is a glitch, and he did not abuse a glitch because he did not actually kill anyone for the time he was inside of the walls. And for me it was no glitching, and I also typed that into my voting message, and I said, yeah, for me this is no glitching, and even if it is, he did not gain any advantage, so he should be unbanned. Yeah. And I also checked the admin votes later on, but yeah, there was no discussion yet afterwards, so that was also pretty much one of those failures. And in that video, in that previous video, which was deleted, and I also did not know that it actually was deleted because the lead admin wanted it so, the lead team wanted it that way, I assumed that the video was deleted because because he decided to do it himself. And if the lead team really wanted to, prevent this from happening again, perhaps they actually should communicate it. But there was nothing, absolutely nothing. No sentence about this, yeah, pretty much misinformation. Yeah. There was this moderator participating in that video, and he, or she rather, said, yeah, I actually don't know what happened back then, because I was not tasked with that case, and I was not in the project back in that time. But yeah, just when you want to get unbanned from the ban list, that was a question of the host, just send a good appeal with a convincing structure, and that's basically it. Absolutely bullshit, because it doesn't matter what kind of convincing content you appear as, it only matters whether you can prove your innocence. Simple example, there was someone banned at GGC, which was in the end just a mistake from the graphic card, a bug, and he got unbanned by GGC later on, and consequently also at the blacklist. Now, as much as this project tries to be professional, there are also some leaks from time to time. And, you know, when I scanned that video for replies, that blacklist video that I participated in, because I was also interested, well, is it really that drastic? Are there really a lot of replies about that particular scene. So no, in the end, of course, there was a bit of general flaming about unfair bans, but actually no one mentioned that particular scene where I used that oh-so-evil sentence. But what I found was someone referring to me participating in macro cases. And the thing is, up to the point of this video, I never used leaked any kind of internal information, never shared anything. So that means this person, who was also banned from macros, must have been informed, and I am pretty sure who that actually was. By now that person is no longer in the blacklist, but that was not the only example. There have been other leaks, and there's still someone that up to now has not been caught. So there's probably still a person here that has the potential to leak information. And after that video decision was made, because eventually Solomon approached me and said, yeah, it does not make much sense by now to delete the video. And I thought, yeah, there's still a bit of common sense left here. But yeah, management structure, and you are allowed to voice your opinion, blah blah blah. But when you sound like you attack another staff member, we will be forced to act. So pretty much a big loophole for him. And I thought, especially in the recent time, I already backed down so much during that macro list, during the white list, and I thought, now it's time again to actually ask some critical questions, because when I have to censor myself, I have no purpose in this project. So the first question about the white list that I asked was, why was this poll made in the first place? And the reply of Solomon was, well, initially this was designed to deal with the subjectiveness of macro cases, and even though we are not supportive of it, it's still the best, thing to do for the blacklist. Now, why does he have the right to decide what is the best thing for the blacklist? Why does he alone have the right? What makes him so special? Yeah, and I was not satisfied by that. I continued to ask some other questions. I asked, why ask for opinions when the decision is predetermined anyway? Why give a false sense of democracy? Why are the interests of a minority in the best interest of the blacklist? Is your opinion worth more than others? Yeah, and I guess that was too much for them. That was something they could not deal with. And especially the reply of Solomon was interesting. He replied, Delta, it is apparent that you did not understand my PM to you explaining that there is a management structure here. That means there will be times when democracy is not used to make decisions. Your continued refusal to accept this fact does not work for this project. So in essence, the price for staying in this project is to ask no critical and no uncomfortable questions. So as a consequence, censorship. If you want to stay in this project, you have to word your posts and opinions very carefully. And yeah, that's simply something that's not for me. I am not letting anyone else dictate what I have to say and what not. And yeah, that was the point where they decided eventually to remove me, because they ran out of arguments once again. And of course, yeah, as a result, my trust in the blacklist is shattered. Especially since Gaza claimed, yeah, we can do whatever we want to. Well, is that really the case? Can they do whatever they want to? Well, not really, because after all, the blacklist is a service for server admins to use. And, well, it's their decision, and if a server admin doesn't approve what the blacklist does, you can simply stop using the service. Yeah, and when many admins would decide to do so, that will actually present a loss of power. So, the power of the blacklist, how strong it is, basically depends on the server admins that are supporting it. And there's also another option because, you know, actually server admins not using the blacklist any longer would be a pretty drastic step because, as a matter of fact, there are quite a lot of people on this blacklist that deserve the entries, and there are even more that deserve it but are not on it. There is also a room for endogenous countermeasures, but that is also not that realistic. But just to go through the theory, if for example all moderators would decide to simply stop their voting, no submissions could proceed. Yeah, and it would come to a halt, and this upper management, so to speak, would have to react. Yeah, and that are some last aspects that I would like to mention. Because, now first of all, the SLEE team is pretty strange because there's this Soulman and this Captain Carrot, and they are pretty much incompetent, in my opinion. And then there's also Gaza, which is pretty much on the verge of corruption. For me, he is corrupted by the decisions that he made. Well, and AJ, I actually have a lot of respect for AJ, and he has a lot of knowledge about those technical things, but he's not really that leader type of person, and also not the person to, yeah, possibly stand up and speak against his lead peers, against at least in the most situations. And another example, because I think for some of them, this T4G blacklist thing is kind of a company thing. The Anglo-American model only knows the board of directors, and that means both the executive and the controlling board or part are made up of shareholders and the management. And that's very critical because they basically control themselves, and when you have to control yourself, chances are it's a very lax control. And there is no participation, no involvement by employees, which you could, I think, translate to as moderators in the first place. So, in Germany, there's actually a term called Aufsichtsrat, and that actually had to be invented into the English language, and it's called Supervisory Board, and it's a board made up by shareholders 50% and also employees 50%, so that actually gives employees an option to control what their management does, and there's participation by the working class. And I think this Soulman and Carrot are stuck in that board of directors model. So yeah, that was a pretty long time to talk. And finally I've reached the finish. Said everything I wanted to say. And yeah, now there is no turning back.
I can't afford to pay. I know you think you're special.